You're the King of glory. You're the King of the angels. You're the King of glory. You're the King of the ages. You're the King of glory. You're the King of the ages. You're the King of glory. You're the King of the ages. And you set my feet a-dancing. You fill my mouth with praise. Lord, you set my feet a-dancing. You fill my mouth with praise. Lord, you set my feet a-dancing. You fill my mouth with praise. King of glory, King of the ages. You're the King of glory. You're the King of the angels. You're the King of glory. You're the King of the ages. You set my feet a-dancing. You fill my mouth with praise. Lord, you set my feet a-dancing. You fill my mouth with praise. Lord, you set my feet a-dancing. You fill my mouth with praise. Oh, King of glory. You're the King of the ages. You're the King of King of the ages. You're the King of glory. You're the King of the ages.
Thank you.
Holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is the Lord.
You're my Savior, you're the mighty one, you're the mighty one. eternal sovereign, eternal king, eternal sovereign, eternal king, eternal sovereign, eternal king. King forever, friend and Savior, King forever, friend and Savior, King forever, friend and Savior. King forever, friend and Savior. You're the 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 King forever, friend and Savior. Amazing God. You're the amazing God, the amazing God. Oh, King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior. We live for your glory. Yeah. We live for your glory. To shout forth with your glory. We live for 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 your glory. You're the King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior.
You're the King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior. You're the King forever, friend and Savior.
Myself to you, I let your ear.
glory and lifter. You're the glory and lifter. You're the glory and lifter of my head. You're the glory and lifter. You're the glory and lifter. You're the glory and lifter of my head. About your mercy, and I sing about your unfailing love, and I sing about your goodness, and I sing about your mercy, and I sing about your unfailing love. Oh, Geneva, glory and the lifter of my head. You're the glory and the lifter. You're the glory and the lifter. You're the glory and the lifter of my head. You're the glory and the lifter. You're the glory and the lifter. You're the glory and the lifter of my
my heart belongs to
Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on me. For you are all I see. My heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on me.
My heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on me. One more time.
Just one more time, one more time.
For you are all I see. My heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come all afresh on me.
Is he all? Is he all you seek? Is he all your heart desires? Is he all? Is he all you seek after? Is he all your heart desires? As we were singing, I saw people with ropes tied to them and anchored to the earth, anchored to the ground. Some of them were small ropes that you'd have to get out a pretty big pair of scissors to try to cut into. Some of them were pretty big ropes that were tied to them that they were anchored to the ground with. And some of them were like the anchor of a ship, the big chains, and they weren't moving, going anywhere. And this was people that are singing the song, "You are all I seek. My heart belongs to you. My heart, my affections, my emotions, my thoughts, my appetites, my desires, the things that I want to see come to fruition in my life. My heart belongs to you, Lord. Or does it belong to me? Does your heart belong to you, really? Do you have ropes that hold you down and tie you to the things of this earth? Do you have things that are holding on to you? And when God says move, you can't because you're connected to the earthly realm. And you're not willing to do what it takes to go get the big scissors out and clip those ropes. If it's a big rope, you got to get maybe a saw out or whatever it takes. You got to get a big thing of pruning shears and try to start gnawing on it or whatever. A chain in the ocean. It takes some work to get that thing up. How anchored are God's people to this earth when our hearts should belong to Him and He should be all we seek after? Can we let go of it all and walk away if Father says, come to me, I have a purpose, I have a plan for you, I've called you, I've separated you, I've put my anointing upon you, and I want you to go and declare my word to the nations of the earth? Are we too anchored? Trying to figure out how we're going to plan and live out our life and how we're going to take care of things and being the one that's figuring it out instead of seeking after Him and following Him to figure it all out. Not counting our lives dear to ourselves, but counting our life dear to the cross of Jesus Christ. Yes. To be dead, buried, and raised up together with Him. This is the true meaning of the work that Christ has done in us. To not count our life dear to us anymore, because it is not our own. It is already bought with the price He paid. The greatest sacrifice, God Almighty shed His blood to purchase our redemption, our salvation, and our life. We belong to Him and not to ourselves. We belong to Him and not to ourselves. Hallelujah. Our life is not our own. The reality of this earth and the cares and the riches and the pleasures and the needs and the desires. We take a little scripture. He that does not work should not eat. And buddy, we rather go to work so we can eat. Simply working in the kingdom, seeking first the kingdom, is all that means. Laying our hand to the plow wherever we're at, doing the Father's business. We don't want to be anchored in any way. To this earth, to think that we need to take care of anything, to think that we need to figure anything out. He has the answer every step of the way. When He called Abraham out, like He's called every one of us out, when He called him out to go to a place that he did not know, he was just like you, except God looked and found a righteous man. So if you're not righteous, it's not counting you. But if you're a righteous man or a woman, it counts you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. But Abraham was a person just like you. He had a lot of responsibilities in this life. It was a whole city that picked up and moved with Abraham when he went out. There was a lot to think about, a lot that could have held him and could have anchored him, could have tied him down to stay right in that place where he was. But God wanted him to be separated from everything that was in that place. God couldn't bring forth the man that he wanted to bring forth in Abraham all the way to the promise, the seed, Jesus Christ. He couldn't bring it forth in the land of Ur. He couldn't bring it forth where Nimrod was. But Abraham was just like you. And he had to just be willing to get up, pack up, and start down the road going where he had no idea where he was going. That must be our walk with the Lord. And it was a long testing period from that point until Abraham lays Isaac on the altar to sacrifice him. It was a long time. Of God working and perfecting those things in Abraham and trying his heart and trying him to see if he could be the man, if he would be the man that this promise could come forth through. If he could be the man that would bring forth a nation that the promise would come through. And when Abraham raised that knife and said, I account it that God will even raise Isaac from the dead. I account it. He will even raise him because this is the promise. He so believed God that he was going all the way. He went all the way. He didn't figure it out and go, well, this isn't like God to want a human sacrifice. He didn't do any of those things that we rationalize the plan and the purposes and the calling of God away in our lives with. Because they don't look pretty enough. They don't look exotic enough. They don't look exciting enough. Serving in the nursery isn't exciting enough. You know, you've got to start somewhere. When you're faithful in the few things, then God makes you ruler over many. Abraham had to be faithful. He had to start out by getting up and just everybody packing up and everybody saying to him, where are we going? And Abraham saying, I don't have a clue. God didn't tell me. Now, what do you think the other people were thinking? There were other men in that group. He doesn't even know where we're going, and we're going. Don't you think people had minds to think back then? I mean, we just say it really, really fast. Abraham got up and he went and he followed God and it was all, you know. There was a life for Abraham to walk out and there's a life for us to walk out. He walked away from everything he knew to come out to receive a promise that he would never see the fulfillment of on this earth. Only the beginning. Only the beginning, only the son Isaac. The beginning of a great promise that is eternal. But he was a pilgrim and a sojourner waiting for that promise, as though it was coming at any moment, as though the promise of Christ was coming at any moment. He lived in tents. He chose. He was one of the richest, most wealthy men around, and he chose to be in tents in an uncertain dwelling place, looking for a city whose builder and maker was God. Do we have our eyes looking for that city? Are we looking for that city whose builder and maker is God? Or are we looking for what we can obtain and putting away our retirement and getting everything all fixed and together for God, for us? You know, we're just helping God out, the arm of the flesh. Getting everything worked out of how we can be successful in this life. It's so easy to get encumbered. We're in this spiritual atmosphere, and if we're not alone with God, our hearts are not panting and they're not crying after Him. We are going to begin to get pulled on and sucked into the things of this life, the things of this world. And our life will be gone, and it won't count for Jesus. It'll count for what we obtain in this earth, and we're not taking any of it with us. You brought nothing into this world, and be sure you're assured you're not taking anything out. So if we can trust God with our salvation and knowing that when we die, we're not taking anything out, we should just be trusting God that He can take care of all of our needs so we can fulfill the purposes and the plans and the calling that God has placed upon our life. And it's only through seeking Him with all of our heart that we will ever come to know. Because He's not looking for half-hearted men and women. He's looking for those that are really sold out, that really have taken on the life of Jesus Christ, that really are dead and buried and raised up together with Him to walk out His purposes, to live out His life here on earth. He's called us to live His life, not our life. That's why we're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's why, it's because it's His life, not ours. It doesn't belong to us anymore, but we hold so dear to it. And that's why we struggle with things in this life, because it doesn't belong to Him. We got to do it. We got to get it all fixed and figured out. Or it would be no struggle, because we would be assured that He will take care of us. We would say, we're fine with what we have now, and we're not concerned about tomorrow. because he will take care of us tomorrow. And we would focus on the plan that he has for our life, on the purpose that he has called us, that he's gifted us by his Spirit. It's all his working. It's none of us. It is all of him. It is only our surrender. It is only our humility. It is only our brokenness. Because the best man has to offer, the best that you can obtain to, the best that you can fix up for God is not good enough, and it will never be pleasing to God. It will be a filthy rag before him. The best we have is filthy rags. The best we can do. So why do we keep trying to do it? Why do we continue to struggle with sin when we're dead and buried and raised with him? If we're struggling with sin and ungodliness, we need to come back to a love relationship with Jesus Christ. We need to fall in love with the one who died for us and rose again. We need to have a realization and an awakening of what he's done. We've let things of this world push down that glorious, I don't even want to call it something as mere as a romance, because that cannot compare. But when you're in that relationship where it's all these stars everybody's seeing, you know, when you fall in love with that person, and that comprehension that a man and a woman has in the understanding of being in love with that person, or a child has that, the comprehension and that love for a parent. But it's a little bit different with that love when you fall in love with someone. You see no one else. You can see no one else. You're not looking around. You found that pearl of great price. You found what you've been looking for. Or you're just half-heartedly going, eeny, meeny, miny, mo, pick a rabbit by the toe. I'll take this one. Okay, that one didn't work. I'll go to the next one. That's not pulling. That ain't it. That's what people do with Christianity. They're like, I don't want to go to hell. I got that. But it's about falling in love with Jesus Christ. Because when you fall in love with him and you receive this salvation, or you come back to your first love, sin is not an issue. Because if sin is an issue, then you're saying that the work that Christ did in us is not enough. And it is enough. It is enough to keep you. It's enough to cause you to humble yourself and to be broken before God and say, Father, you're all I need and you're all I'm seeking after. I'm not going to seek after the things of this world. I'm not going to let the sin or ungodliness in any way hold on to my life and dictate to me about what I'm going to do and what I'm going to be. You can't serve two masters. You either love the one or hate the other, and hate the other. Or you cleave to the one and you despise the other. There's only one master. And the issue, if he is not your all in all, is that you need to come back to your first love. And you can look in that church, at that church in Revelation chapter 2, the first church of Ephesus. And you can go through that. And they were doing great and mighty deeds. They were a powerful church. They were radical for God. They got so busy about doing the work of Christ that they completely lost that love and that fellowship and that relationship with him. And they were not focused on him and him alone and allowing him to do everything through him. See, that's how you're free from sin, is because you allow the Holy Spirit to do the work on the inside of you. You allow the Holy Spirit, you depend upon Him to say no to those things that would pull you and distract you. You allow Him through you to say no. You allow Him to be your strength. You allow Him to be your victory. You allow Him to be your authority. You allow Him to teach you how to walk on the water. But as long as we're hanging on, there's a fight, there's a battle. As long as we're not getting out and cutting the strings loose and saying, it's enough, it's enough. I have decided to follow Jesus. And I'm not going to let the discouragements and the things of this earth that would try to allure me or pull on me, I'm not going to allow them to affect me anymore, because I've made up my mind, I'm following Jesus. Amen. If you understand that those that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, if you take a hold of that and you embrace that and know that that is your life that you've been called to, then you won't be affected so greatly by what comes when the wind blows. When the waves are billowing over. When your house doesn't stand. Is it only when everything's going good? When you've got your house and you got your job and you got your car and you got... Is that the only time that you can be happy, is when it looks like everything's going smooth? How about like Paul was when they left him for dead? I believe it's Acts chapter 14. They stoned him and they left him for dead. Didn't seem like that was a bright day for Paul, does it? They left him for dead. Well, I believe he was dead. But as the saints were gathered around him, he got up. He got up from under that pile of stones. If they thought he was dead, he was buried. Now you imagine those big old stones hitting you in every which direction. You know, we say it too quickly. This is Paul. This is one of the most mighty men of God ever to walk upon the face of the earth, and he's left under a pile of stones. And if we haven't prayed through our mansion and our Mercedes, you know, we've got problems. And, this life today is like, if you don't have it, then, you know, people are upset because they suffer persecution because their house and car isn't fancy enough. You must not be a very righteous person, because God says he's going to bless the righteous. What is real blessings? What are real riches? What are they? Are they eternal or are they earthly? They're eternal. That's the real riches. What you have on earth, what God blesses you with on earth, is just a little extra plus. But the riches are the heavenly riches. It's not about laying up our treasures here on earth where moth and dust corrupt. And don't you know that? Women, you get a new wool sweater and you only get to wear it a couple of times, and you go to get it next year and it has all these holes in it. And some of the guys forget to check. I've forgotten to check. And you wear it to church and all of a sudden you look down, there's a big old hole. Because the moth ate right through that treasure. It was a treasure. You went and bought it for yourself. You liked it. It looked pretty. And you was just like coming to church looking so great. You know, pulled out your sweater from last year. And everybody's looking and going, does he or she know they got a big old bunch of big old holes in the back of their sweater? That's earth. But the riches of heaven, that white robe that he clothes us with, that glory that he places upon us, those are true riches. Those are riches that will last forever and ever. And that's all this life should mean to us. The reality of who He is and what He's called us to be. In Him. In Christ Jesus. In Him. Doing what He has called us to do. Living His life. Are we living His life in this world, or are we living our own life? Can we truly say that we are living out the life of Jesus Christ? In everything that we're doing. Or can we look around and find a few ropes that are tugging us and tying us to the earth? God's looking for a people that will get out the scissors, the big pruning shears, whatever it takes to pull the anchor up and follow Him. Lose your life, even unto the death. Losing our life even unto the death for Jesus Christ. I mean, you have to be careful with saying that now, because there's crazy people out there that die thinking they're going to go to heaven and, you know, get 12 wives when they, you know, blow themselves up. I mean, just a bunch of craziness. All the stuff that Satan tries to mock at God with, the reality of who we are to bring the gospel, to lay down our life, to love. Even unto the death with us means that we would die bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ to you. Thinking of the video that Pastor Mark posted on his Facebook, I think it was yesterday. My husband's been watching that, trying to figure out how to post that on Facebook. He's been watching that continually, been listening to that for at least 8 months. At least 8 months it is. I was trying to think today how long he's been playing that over and over when we go to bed at night. I hear that continually. And thinking about the man that bought the 3,000 slaves. And he said, I'm going to bring them to an island. And if there's going to be no preachers there. And if somebody that would preach the gospel is shipwrecked, we'll keep them all locked up in a house where they can't get to the people, because I'm done with this religion nonsense. I'm done with this. And these two young Moravian boys heard this. They heard the 3,000 souls that were going to be on an island without the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they went and they sold themselves into slavery. They sold themselves to that man. And they took the money for the price of their slavery that they sold themselves for and bought the ticket on a ship to go to the island to be slaves for the rest of their lives so they could preach the gospel to 3,000 people, 3,000 slaves. How many wants to run and get on that calling? Real quick. Yeah, Mike, I believe you would. I've been around you enough to believe you would, Mike. But as their family and everyone come to see them off and come to say, you know, what are they thinking? Is this really God? Is this what they should be doing? Is this a mistake? The two young boys get on the ship. And as they begin to almost get out of yelling distance, they yell, may the Lamb of God say it, David. Receive the reward of His sufferings. They were saying through their life. May the Lamb of God receive. The last words ever heard from those two mothers, boys, those two fathers, young boys, that they had hopes and they had plans and they had dreams of. The last thing they hear them say is, may the Lamb of God receive the reward of His sufferings. And it became the missionary theme for the Moravians. May we each one be that passionate for God. May we cut those things that are anchoring us to this earth, may we cut them loose, and may we truly decide to follow Jesus all the way and hold on to nothing. This is the life that he's called us to, and he's preparing us for a day and an hour, a critical time, a critical purpose. Not to assimilate into the earth and into the world, but to be the light, shining bright for him. To be those that are willing to suffer with him. If you suffer with him, 2 Timothy. I'm going to read that passage. In chapter 2. Here's Paul talking to Timothy in verse 9. Wherein I suffer trouble because of the gospel in verse 8. Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the resurrection of the dead, I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds. But the word of God is not bound. There, even though I'm in bonds, Paul chose to be a prisoner for the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was his calling. And he chose to give himself to it. How many of us back up from our calling and go, it's too much? Different things we have to do in this ministry. Pack up, move up, do this, fix that. You know, the busyness that we depend upon the people. We depend upon the people in the house of God, not to go and hire people to do the work, but we depend upon the people in the house of God to be the people of God and to take a part in what we're doing in the ministry and just lay your hand to the plow. Maybe it doesn't look like you're preaching the gospel, but you're enabling the gospel to be preached. You're enabling it to go forth from that YouTube. You're enabling it to go out in the daily breads. By every place that you put your hand to the plow, you're being a part of this ministry. And I said to some of the guys the other day, you know, I said, I was thinking about, Lord, why this and that and the other? And the Lord brought to my mind about when the children of Israel were walking through the wilderness. How, when the cloud moved, they had to pack up their tents. They had to pack up the tabernacle. They had to pack up everything and move with the cloud. And if cloud was there a week, they'd set up their tents and be there. They didn't know how long it was going to be, so they didn't go there and sit on their tents and wait. And they didn't go there and say, should we set up the tabernacle or not? They went there and they set up the tabernacle, and the cloud picked up and moved in a week, they picked everything up and they followed the cloud. If it was a month, they picked everything up and they followed the cloud. If it was a year, they picked everything up and they followed the cloud. Because the cloud was their provision, it was their direction, it was the only way through the wilderness. So if God wants us to pick up and follow the cloud, are we going to sit there and go, I don't have time to pick up and follow the cloud. I'm busy. Or do you go, pretty tight, busy, over here, busy, can't be there. Are we willing to say, Jesus, where you are, I'll be. What you're doing, I'm doing. What you're saying, I'm saying. Where you're going, I'm going. How you're living, I'm living, because I'm in you and you're in me. And you're in the Father. And the Father's in you. And I'm in you and the Father. And I'm living the kingdom of heaven, not the kingdom of earth. I'm living in you, Lord. All the way. All the way. Is there anything in your life that God's put his finger on and you've like, nobody else does that? The Lord's like, over here, over here. Nobody else does that. Look around. So all the ministries, we see them, they don't do that. But the Holy Spirit says, will you be Abraham? Will you be Isaiah? Will you come be an Ezekiel? Will you come be my man, my woman. And the Lord puts his finger on and you say, you can have everything here, Father, but I want this, and I want this, and I want this, and I want that. Do you talk yourself out of where the Holy Spirit's leading you? Or do you follow him? It's all a love relationship. It's being in love with him to the point that you will not hold on to your life. You won't count it dear to yourself. You're not going to hold on to it. You're just going to get up and say, I'm done. I'm done holding on to my life. Now, Jesus, come and fill me. I tell you what, when you let go, he'll fill you up. When you let go, he'll explode on the inside of you. When you say, I'm done, I can't do it, he says, child, I've been waiting on you to say you can't do it. That you can't fix you up. That you can't make yourself an overcomer to present yourself to Jesus. That you overcome through the blood of Christ Jesus. Realizing that. See, the reason so many people wrestle with sin and ungodliness is because they're trying to do it. They're not looking to Jesus. They're not looking to the Savior to do it in them and through them. They're looking to them and their ability. And as long as you do that, you're going to fail because God will not have your righteousness. He provided all the righteousness you need. It's in him. It is his ability. And he will not allow you to come with your righteousness. It stinks. He wants you to come broken and humble and willing to accept his way, which is always laying down your life like he laid down his life on the cross. It's always looking down from that cross and saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They didn't apologize to him. I know so many Christians that won't forgive somebody because they didn't apologize to him. I go, are you out of your mind? Well, they didn't repent. Well, you're proud and haughty and you stink. If you have something against somebody that they did to you, something they did against you, you need to go and apologize to them. And tell them you're sorry for any way you ever offended them. My grandson came to me the other day when they were all together, making a bunch of racket as kids will do. What a pleasant sound of racket. Children that can make lots of noise. And thank you, Jesus, for 9 and almost 10 very healthy grandbabies that are able to just run around and have a blast. And one of them came to me and said, so-and-so hit me. And I said, well, go apologize to him. So-and-so hit me. Well, go tell him you love him and you're sorry and what can you do to help him. So-and-so hit me. Go tell him that you love him and that you're sorry. And is there anything you can do to help him? And he went on about his business. And that was the last I heard. That's Jesus. That's serving. That's loving. It's not trying to defend yourself and get it all fixed up for you. It's being like Jesus. Oh, and see, that's what Ephesus had forgotten. They had forgotten that first love. They got to hating the sin of the Nicolaitans so much that they hated the Nicolaitans. And it wasn't the people that God hates. It's the sin he hates. He loves the people. He died for them. And even when we reject him, he loves us so much that he will go to great extents for the hope that he can bring us back to him. He's not like we are. Cut him off. Don't talk to him anymore. They come over here, you go over there. I tried that. I'm just telling you what I tried. I'm just telling you what I tried before. I wasn't going to be in conflict. I was going to be a good girl. And this person, when they came, it was always, you know, let's fight it out. Let's get this out. Let's deal with this. Let's, you know, and there was always something to deal with. There was always a. So I decided that person comes in, they've got something with me. I'm going to exit stage left. And I am just going to go about my pious way. And I'm going to be so good. It so stank. And the Lord told me, because I was seeking the Lord, I was spending a lot of time at that time of my life fasting and praying and crying out to God. A lot of time. This is a huge time in changing in my life and my relationship with Jesus and my calling and the purposes and the plans that God had for my life. And the Lord told me, as long as you walk the other way and you do not confront and you do not deal with it, you will stay right here in this place. You're stuck until you deal with it. Right here. I wasn't the one trying to start the fight. I wasn't the one causing the problem. I was Miss Goody Two Shoes. Yeah, because it had some of my righteousness on it. It did. It had me trying to look good for God. How many try to look good for God? Just tell the truth. You're doing it every day. And so I did not like the fact that I was not going any deeper in the things of God and I wasn't going to grow and I was going to stay right in that place until I dealt with it. So I decided to deal with it. And, you know, one thing I hated at that time in my life was confrontation. I hated confrontation. I did not like yelling. I was very, you know, people wouldn't believe this about me, but I was a very timid girl growing up. I was very quiet, very timid, and if somebody got upset with me, I would get sick and throw up. I mean, if my brother and sister told me that there was some kind of a monster in the woods or some crazy thing, and they did one time, I walked home, walked right into the house and threw up. Because I mean, like, things affected me. I was very quiet, shy, timid. And I know nobody believes that. If my mom was here, she could tell you. But I hated confrontation. I don't like confrontation now, but when the Holy Ghost comes on me, I mean, I've been amazed. He can just get right up in people's face. I had to get up in somebody's face that was yelling at me the other day in the city that thinks that they're the boss of the things of the kingdom of God. And they yelled at me, and I found myself yelling back in the Holy Ghost. But it was the Holy Ghost. It was Him. Because after I realized what I'd done, I said, Lord, what in the world did I just do? You flowed. Because that ended it, and it broke it, and they got sweet. And we had a nice, sweet conversation from that point on. But so I went after that thing head on, and I went right into that confrontation. And I'm like, let's get this done. And we dealt with it. And I said, now that is enough of this business. And I'm not having it anymore. No more of this fighting and picking and carrying on. Done. End of it. And along with it, after we got through the whole thing, and it was by the Holy Spirit, I just called it out. I'm like, you can tell me all my problems. Go ahead. Now are you done? But I didn't say it like that. I did it humbly. I was broken. But I mean, you know, that's how you look at it. You're just like, but, you know, the Lord gave me an anointing and a grace to listen to it and say, okay, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I didn't point out any of their problems. I didn't tell them what they did. I didn't argue with them. I just, forgive me. I'm sorry. Now let's be done. No more of this. No more. And I went out and I bought them a beautiful gift. It was something that I knew that they really liked, and I went into the store that I don't normally go into, and I found a whole big set of this thing that they really cherished, and I bought it. It was an amazing price, and I took it to their house, and I said, I have a gift for you. And someone that just chewed you out up one side and down the other and told you all your problems, and here you're bringing them a gift and telling them how much you love them. It changed the thing. It changed it. God requires of us to be like Him, to be like Jesus, not to defend ourselves, not to count ourselves dear, but to be willing to lay down our life to the point that Paul was under the pile of stones. And we can't take some words coming against us. We can't take a little bit of, that's not even persecution for the gospel of Jesus Christ. That does us in. We get all upset and have to defend ourselves and have to put up all these walls of protection. And everybody in here has done that too. Got to protect ourselves so that doesn't happen again. No, just dive right into it and say, I'm sorry. Forgive me. Forgive me. Be the wrong, even if you're right. Be like Jesus. Be like Him. I mean, He came with authority, and He spoke with authority, and He put the scribes and the Pharisees in their place. But He also died for them. And He also said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And right now, most of us aren't even haven't graduated to the place to take the authority. We still need to be the place of the humble, the lowly, the broken. The I'm sorry and I apologize. So we can go on from the little meager place that we are so encumbered with this life and with this world. That we're counting our life dear to ourselves and not dear to the cross. We're called and we're anointed and we're sought out by Him. Because God so loves the world. The church we live in today has to get saved to be able to go out to the world. I love what Pastor Mark said when, you know, you think about how we need revival. We need a reviving in the church. But I like what Pastor Mark said about drawing the circle on Sunday. Just draw a big circle, get in the circle, and have revival. If every one of us will get in the circle and have revival for ourselves, we'll come in with revival. We'll be revival. We'll live revival. Revival will be when we're at home. Revival will be when we're at work. Revival will be wherever we go, if we're in the grocery store, because we'll bring revival with us. Somebody was telling me on the phone today, a preacher was telling me on the phone today about how they need a revival where they're at, and that they didn't see any hope for revival where they're at. And I said, well, Pastor Mark said on Sunday, draw a big circle. Get in the circle. Start having revival. Get into revival. You and Jesus. That's where revival begins. You and Jesus. You have revival with Jesus. And then you go be revival. You live revival. You walk out revival. You be the revival where you're at. Don't wait for revival to come. Live in revival. That's what He's called us to, not wait on somebody else to do something, not come dragging into the church and waiting on the pastor to do something to help us get through our little mediocre problems that we have and our issues, and none of them are even basically counted as persecution for the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're mostly persecution for the stupid stuff we do. And sometimes it's fire to bring us into maturity, and we're whining all the way. We're not going, let me tell you, King, whether we live or we die, whether God saves us out of that fire or He doesn't, we will not bow our knee to you. We ain't even got that far to the fire. We just get into the little easy bake oven, stick our finger in there under the little light, and we're like, ow! And whining. We must be willing to go through the fire joyfully, counting it all joy to suffer persecution for godliness, for righteousness. We must be willing joyfully to go through and not come to church in an expectation that maybe we can get some help because it's been a tough week. But come living, walking out, breathing revival, bringing it into the place, and the place explode when we come together. I was reading 2 Timothy chapter 2. I think I'm on verse 10 now. Therefore, I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Paul says, I'm enduring what I'm doing, enduring for your sake, for the sake of those that will come to the gospel of Jesus Christ. He endured for the sake of the gospel. Are you enduring for the sake of the gospel? Are you enduring because you're having to lose some of your earthly possessions? Because God might be saying over here, somebody might have come and repossessed your couch and your refrigerator, and now you're majorly persecuted. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, this is the word of God, dead. I think Christians have a continual resurrection, and it's not a godly resurrection. They continually get resurrected from the dead of being dead to themselves and alive unto Christ Jesus. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead, past tense, with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. Do our works deny him? Does our lack of opening our mouth and declaring the gospel because we might be persecuted or people might think we're kind of weird or it might look awkward if we open our mouth and speak about the Lord Jesus Christ, or people might look at us with a strange look, so we just stand there in silence and deny him who bought us? He'll deny us. But if we're willing to suffer the reproach with him, we'll reign with him. If we believe not, he abides faithful. He cannot deny himself. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He won't deny the Father. He took it all the way to the cross. And he won't deny. Himself. It's basically denying yourself when you deny him, because you just denied yourself eternal life through Jesus Christ, because he's going to deny you. Are we willing to really take a look at our life and examine our hearts and say, are we the church that Jesus Christ paid for with his own blood? Are we the church? Are we living out that life? Are we so in love with him that we don't count our lives dear to ourselves anymore, but we're looking and we're saying, Father, what is your purpose and your plan for me? Father, I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. Father, I'm not going to do it my own way. Take it all. Take it all away. If it all goes, if I lose my house tomorrow and I lose my car tomorrow and I lose my job tomorrow and I lose everything and it all comes to an end and all I have is me and my spouse and my children, and that's all that's left, I won't deny you, Jesus. I'm following you because those things don't matter. They're only temporal. There's a lot of people that can say yes, but they've never walked through it. They've never had it all taken away. And you know why? Because you weren't ready. You just thought you were. And God's so good and He's so merciful. He's just waiting for you to come. And say, really, Father, it is yours. Really, Father, it's not mine. Really, Father, I'm following you. My life is yours. It doesn't belong to me. Matthew chapter 10. Man, in this book, Jesus sends his disciples out. And it's powerful. And you look at it, and he calls his 12 disciples together, and he gives them power. He gives them power. And you know, and I like looking at that, the power that he gives them. It's not a power that when they get out there, they have to go, well, maybe I can lay my hands on the sick and they'll recover. Maybe I can go and raise the dead. Well, let's fast and pray and get together and let's just really press in. All 12 of us get together and just really go after this. And let's, you know, we'll go out there and we'll just, you know, we'll go after doing what Jesus did. He gave them power and they went out there and they did what he did. When he gave them the gift, they had the gift. When he gives us the gift, we got it. We either got the goods or we don't got the goods, right? Now there are situations where Jesus didn't do many miracles in Nazareth because of their unbelief. And so there are situations like that, but when God gives you the power and the authority, and just realizing that you have it, that it's not of you and not of yourself, but it's of Him. And that's a whole nother message, and I'd like to get into that one. The power that He's given us, and this is where we need to focus. But I just hear the Lord saying, you know, in this chapter, He's giving the disciples power, and then He's giving them commission. And He's telling them how to live out and walk this out, and how to live their life. And he's getting ready to send them out to go. And he just gives them, he lays out the whole principle of how they're to do it, how they're to walk it out. And I mean, it's pretty radical. I mean, most people are like, okay, got to have the bank account, got to have these securities, got to have this, got to do that, got to get this all in order. And then when the perfect time, the Lord told him, he says, look, don't even take your scrip for your journey. Don't even take two coats, neither shoes, nor staves, for the workman's worthy of his hire. I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to take care of you. You don't go prepared to take care of yourself. You go prepared to preach the gospel. I've given you power, and the power is enough. It's enough. But anyway, I want to get over here to Verse 16, behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents, harmless as doves. But beware of men, for they shall deliver you up to the council, and they shall scourge you in the synagogue. And you shall be hated, and you should be brought before, you should be brought before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. And when they deliver you up, take no thought what you shall say. For it shall be given to you that same hour what you're to speak. For it is not you that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaks in you. See, such a key right there. Because we go all the time preparing and trying to figure out and getting ready for what we're going to say. And it's so much better when you just rely upon the Holy Ghost and just say, Father, I don't have anything to say, but I'm ready to say what you want me to say. I'm here. I'm prepared by the Spirit. I prayed in the Holy Ghost enough that I know that I'm yielded up for you to take over and you to speak through me, because I don't have a clue what I'm supposed to do. And nobody can give it to you but Him. It's flowing in the Holy Ghost that works it all out, and waiting on the Holy Spirit. And the brother shall deliver up the brother to death, and the father the child, and the children shall rise up against the parents and cause them to be put to death, and ye shall be hated of all men for my sake. But he that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved. He that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved. Him that is willing, when, you know, there's so many people that come to Jesus, and I watch it again and again and again. And there was this young man, and I'm gonna give you this example. There was this young man that David and I brought to Jesus. He came to our house one day. He's a good friend of my younger brother's, and he came to our house one day, and he's just like, I'm sick of this life. And he goes, I know what you guys have is real, and I want it, and I'm done. This life has been torment to me. He was a very, very talented young man. And, you know, he could sing, like, amazingly, and just a lot of talents that he had. And he said, I just want Jesus. And I'm telling you, that boy got born again by the Spirit. The glory of God just came on him and changed him. And he was so excited. All he wanted to do was, you know, can we go tell people about Jesus? All my old friends, let's go get them. Let's, you know. And he was just after it and so excited. And his mother found out he got saved, good old Catholic woman. And you know, if your son goes into another denomination in Catholicism, then the mother goes to hell. And so you have to take a hold of that son and fight for him. I mean, you know, Catholicism has a lot of crazy teachings in it. You know, not saying that there aren't Catholic people that are born again, because there are many. But, you know, and some Catholics may not even have that teaching or that doctrine. But where we were, it was very strongly taught. So I'll just say that. And I'm telling you what, those Catholic moms would fight. And so anyway, she fought him and 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 fought him until he wearied and he backslid. And I mean, he tried. He so wanted to come to Jesus. But such the battle that went on, not willing to walk away from mom. You know, there's a time that people have to do this. I've watched it over and over again. The family, all upset because now our son goes to that church over there and he's so on fire for God that he won't go out with us for his 21st birthday so he can drink alcohol. And so they must have, you know, they've just over-churched him. They must be a cult because, you know, the church we go to, you can drink alcohol. But he doesn't want any part of it. He doesn't want anything to do with it. And I mean, we watched this over and over again. And this young man, he went so far from God. I mean, this is years and years ago. And now his life is just a total train wreck. A total train wreck. And he's caught up in the rainbow society. Just a mess. There's a place that you've always got to come where it's, though none go with me, still I will follow. If I have to leave mom and dad, if I have to leave son or daughter, no matter what, I will follow Jesus. Amen. I will. That can be a rope that some people have tied to them that's held them to the earth, that they will not cut loose. And because it's everyone, it's every person, you're going to have persecution somewhere. And you have to be willing, no matter what mom or dad or this or that one says, you must have your relationship with Jesus Christ. You are the only one that can have that relationship with Jesus Christ. And you can't let somebody else get their hands in that relationship with Jesus Christ. And if you have, you must go back to your first works and you must repent and you must love him more than you love father or mother, brother or sister, son or daughter. Or anything in this life, he must be more important to you than anyone or anything. There is nothing that you can allow to stop you from having your relationship with Jesus Christ. Not even a spouse. There's women that have husbands. And it's mostly women, more women than men, but have husbands that the husband tries to put a demand on them that you can't go to church And then they'll fight that battle through. You can't pray in this house. You can't this. You can't that. Don't you pray over the children. Don't you do this. Look, the scripture says that if the unbelieving is willing to abide with the believing, let them stay. Because you could win them for the gospel. But do you have to realize that he has to be willing or she has to be willing to abide with the believing? Because you cannot back down and come under that persecution. Because if Satan can stop your mouth and stop you from praying and having a godly home, he'll affect your children and he'll take your children to hell. But if you'll stand for the gospel of Jesus Christ and you'll stand in the midst of the persecution in your home, and your husband's willing to stay, he can stay. Otherwise, hit the road, Jack, and don't come back.
Amen.
Just whatever. Because you have to make up your mind that you are going to follow Jesus.
Yes.
And there's not one person in this room and one person on this earth that will not go through that thing of, though none go with me, still I will follow. You must, everyone, make that decision for yourself. We watched a young Hindu girl come to Jesus recently, and she came to Jesus with all of her heart, and she went home and her mom's like, no! And her friends, her Hindu friends, would come with her, pulling on her. No! And to think one day, if she doesn't come back to Jesus, just like the young man that I told you about, if she doesn't come back to Jesus, burning eternally in hell, because she wasn't willing to suffer the persecution of her family. She said, I can't. I dealt with her 2 or 3 times. She goes, I can't. I want to, but I can't. My mother, my family, they expect of me. They want me. They have their plans for me. And I can't. I can't. Is hell worth it? How about us? How about the people in here that have things tied? You're anchored to things of this life and you won't let go. That's not being dead to your life and hid in Christ Jesus. That's being alive to yourself. And Father's saying, he's saying, cut the strings, cut the ropes, pull up the anchor and let go of your life. And saying, Father, it doesn't matter the persecution I go through. Father, I want you to prepare me for every good work now. I want you to prepare me for what is ahead. I want you to prepare me, Father, to be willing to be like Paul was in that pile of stones. And as the men of God stood around him, he raised up from the dead. I believe it was a resurrection. When I get to heaven, I'm going to go ask him. And then he went on the next day to preach the gospel. Now you know he was a bloody bruised mess. He was a bloody bruised dead mess. And he raised up and he went on to fulfill the purpose that God had for him. He didn't sit and whine and complain and moan about it. Or hold on. His life was not dear to himself. Now I just believe, and I know, because I saw in the spirit of the beginning of this message, when they were up there singing, I saw those ropes and those ties, and I saw them holding people. And Father's saying, cut them, cut them, cut them, cut them, cut those ties, and say, okay, Father God, I come to you wholeheartedly. Lord Jesus, I repent, and I'll do my first works again. That love relationship, Jesus, it's you and no other. It's you and no other. It's you and no other. Now, if the Lord is dealing with you and you feel that in your spirit, I want you to come up quickly. I don't want you to just wait around. I want you to come up quickly. 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 Things are holding on. They're keeping you tied to the earth. To where you can't do everything. That God has asked you to do. You don't step out when he says step out. You don't let go when he says let go. You figure things out. Well, the honest ones are up here. We thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father. We praise you, Father. We praise you, Father. We praise you, Father God. Lord Jesus, that we return to our first love, every one of us. Lord Jesus, we don't just hate the deeds that the Nicolaitans do. We don't hate the sin, but we hate anything, Father, that's not pleasing to you. We hate our own self-righteousness. We hate anything, God. We hate anything, Father God, that's not pleasing to you. Father, we cry out to you right now. Lord Jesus, cause us to be so in love with you that we will not hold on to anything in this world, much less ever step over into the realm of sin and ungodliness that would separate us from your love, oh God. Father, we cry out to you. We cry out to you, Father God. Send your fire, Lord God, and burn up, Lord, everything that would hold us, that would tie us down to this earth. Father, we surrender all right now. We surrender all to follow you, Jesus, not to hold on, but to follow you. Jesus, you are more than enough. You paid the price. You paid the price, Lord Jesus, and it is the answer. And we will live in that answer. We will not live in ourselves and our own ability, but we will live in Christ Jesus and be more than an overcomer through Christ who strengthens us to stand in face of every battle, every storm. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So bye. Let's just all stand and pray with these ones that have come up. In Jesus' name. Father, I just thank you right now that as your people take a hold of you, as they take a hold of you tonight and they say, look, I'm not having anything that's tying me to this earth. I'm going to be willing and ready to go wherever God wants me to go and do whatever God wants me to do, and I'm not going to have anything holding on to me. I thank you, Father, that you baptize every one of them with the fire of the Holy Ghost as they stand right here, Lord. A fresh fire of the Holy Ghost. A fresh fire of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Right now. Father, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Yes, Ata. Lurokuchena. Detela. Genama. Father, I just thank you for this anointing, this calling that you have placed upon Lindsay. Father, and I thank you, Father, that her heart is to fulfill it. Lord, just right now, she releases those things that have held her back. That have held her back and tried to tie her down right now in Jesus' name. Lord Jesus, and she says, yes, I'm willing. I'm willing, oh God. I'm willing. In Jesus' name. By the Spirit, right now, baptize afresh in the fire of the Holy Ghost. Yeah, Father, in Jesus' name, all the hurt and all the pain. Father, all the disappointment goes out right now. Father, the disappointment. Father, it goes. All the hurt. The disappointment goes right now in Jesus' name. We just yank that thing out. That's a lie. That's a lie of the enemy. It's a lie of the enemy. And we break it right now. And Father, we just replace it with peace that passes all understanding in the name of Jesus. Peace. We speak peace. Peace in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus, we speak peace in Jesus' name. Peace. I thank you, Father, that Amy is going to walk out what you've called her to do by the Spirit. Not by understanding. Not by the understanding of men. But by the Spirit, by the peace that passes all understanding, by the knowing, by the assurance. Father, you don't call us to do anything that you don't give us the grace to do. That you don't give us the provision to do. that you don't give us whatever it takes to walk it out. In Jesus' name. 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 Just every one of you, you just cry out to the Lord for yourself. Everyone in this place. Everyone that stayed in your seat. You just talk to the Father. Every one of you that stayed back there that's living in your first love. Amen. Walking out everything Jesus wants you to walk out and doing everything, every moment Jesus wants you to do. Zete, just touch heaven. Zile miyanto nenemo zunye nenemo shele. Broshele. Jimala. Brokede. Zelemo. Jelero vas noka. Lershila. Brokote. Brotete dada. Jinale. Zukopara. Jimale hebrosute. Jela. In Jesus' name. Zelebra sudarvande yushkola jibela zvrete lelelama boroko di diashene. Hallelujah, Jesus. Boy, this is a quiet church tonight. You don't have to be sad. You do this all with rejoicing. Father, I'm so thankful that you're working every perfect thing in me. Yeshota zelema jude. You just stand right here and talk to Jesus. Father, we thank you for the fire of heaven. We thank you, Father, for the fire of heaven. We thank you, Father, for the glory of heaven. We thank you, Father, for the saints of God that are not going to let anything entangle them in this earth, oh God. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Yes, Father. Yeah. 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 And that is how you overcome. By the Spirit. Yes, Father, light the fire. 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 Light the fire, Father. Lekera. Lekera. Yes. Out of your belly flows that river. Jumande. Out of your belly, out of your belly, out of your belly is the answer to every question. Zende, brosha by the Spirit, mandele sukoma, le roshona, richele boshola, bashele, manzele, mandele lekele, zetela, jitala, rotore na batsura, manze. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Yeah. 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 Fire, I just thank you that the glory of God is seen all over Rebecca. Father God, I thank you for the anointing, and she just goes about doing the things that you give her to do. Lord, just moment by moment, listening to your voice, whatever you say. Lord Jesus, she doesn't question the Holy Spirit. She just steps out and moves. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Zibilena Matu. Father, I thank you for a people, Father, that live in that circle of revival. Father, that live in that circle of revival. Father, they will have revival for themselves. They don't have to look for somebody else to have revival for them. They don't have to look for the next speaker or even Pastor Mark. But Father, that relationship that you've called them to, Father, to be revived in you continually, daily. Walking in that first love. Walking in their first love, Father. We thank you, Jesus, for a people that will live, Father, and walk in your presence in the fire of the Holy Ghost, moving and operating in them everywhere they go, bringing revival with them. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to your holy name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Father. Well, as we continue to worship the Lord, you can sing a song. As we continue to worship the Lord, we want to give everybody the opportunity to give. Now, if you're on the floor and the Lord is working something in you, don't worry about getting up, but everybody, please don't step on somebody. Hallelujah. We want to allow you to just be able to come and worship the Lord with what he's given you. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord.
Just like we watched the miracle for Brian. Just miracles.
Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name. In Jesus.
Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus.
Fire.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Fire.
Praise the name
fire.
Of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord.
We trust you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for your river of living water, your supply of God. Father, your supply. Your supply, not Jonathan's supply. Your supply, your supply, your supply. The supply, Father, from heaven. The supply from heaven. The supply from heaven. The supply from heaven. The supply for heaven in Jesus. Yeah, yeah, come on. Come on, come on. Father, baptize in the fire of the Holy Ghost. Baptize in the fire of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Jele mo korebe risan. Rinde le rabako riva shura. Brende le rabako. Dele nan manzele le kor shela. Rebele manzova rabai. Ringele le le yashukara mandi. Jine rabasura. Mele na mande. No distractions. Jino. Leno mo kubara bitele mo chula bashe. Risele mandura batiglinga. In Jesus' name. Yeshele. Revival fire all the time, Father. Revival fire all the time. All the time, Father. Revival fire all the time. Revival fire all the time. Hallelujah. Revival fire. Jikona. Jena da da. In Jesus' name. If there's anybody here that doesn't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, we want to give you the opportunity to come to Jesus. So if you'd like to come to the glorious Savior that has come to redeem you from the powers of darkness and the misery that you're in. You may not realize how much misery you're in, but we want to give you the opportunity to come to Jesus if you don't know him. So you can come up here real quick.
Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Just praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of thank you.
Thank you.